Moving a little bit on, David has mentioned already that the approach that is used often for this vaccine effectiveness study is the one of the cohort approach or the case control study. And these are called usually in epidemiology, these are called observational study. There is a third type of study which is common in epidemiology, and they are called ecological studies. And there is a profound difference that I would like to highlight between the observational study that David has mentioned and the ecological studies, in that the hypothetical association between the outcome and the variable that you are trying to study, they are not the data, they are not collected from the same individuals. David before has mentioned that when you select, for example, a case under a case control study, then you will check if that case has been vaccinated or not, and then you will build your odds of cases that have been vaccinated. In the case of ecological study, this is not done. In fact, these studies, they are usually cheap, they can be implemented in a very short time. But there is obviously a methodological problem because what you are trying, the association that you are trying to build based on the data is an hypothetical association. So sometimes these studies are the initial point to make an hypothesis, which has to be further substantiated by more accurate study. Just to give an example, in our case, the preliminary hypothesis to be tested would be that the vaccine is non-effective, and among the cases, the proportion of vaccinated is high. So this means that you have two sources of information. One is coming from the cases that you are able to detect through your surveillance system, and the other one is coming from another source, that is, for example, the survey or records that you might have available because of the implementation of your vaccination campaign. So you are trying to put together these two types of information to obtain an estimation of the vaccination efficacy. And this is the equation that you will use if you want to make this if you want to make use of this rapid screening method. Obviously, in order for the vaccination effectiveness to be high, this means that these two quantities, they have to be small, and they are small either when the proportion of vaccinated among cases is small, and when the proportion of unvaccinated in the general population is also small, which means that you will have an equation in which it's one minus small quantities, which will give you an idea of the vaccine effectiveness. I can anticipate that these type of studies are usually not suggested unless you are sure that the data on the vaccination coverage are very accurate. Otherwise, it's better not to try not to use it, or at least use it as a preliminary assessment. But then, if you have to go more in detail, you should try to design a more accurate study with the two methodological approach that David has mentioned before. So, obviously, as with anything, there are advantages and disadvantages, and here in this table, you will see what could be the advantages and disadvantages of using one of the three methodological approaches that we have been discussing. One important thing is that the rapid screening method, they are cheap, they are simple, but there is no, basically, the risk factors or other outcomes that David has mentioned before that you will not be able to evaluate. So this is another consideration that you may want to take into account. Whenever we are moving into any type of epidemiological study, not only effectiveness study, which are, by the way, epidemiological study, one important thing is to be considered is the possibility that you may have a bias introduced in your design. And what do we mean about bias, let's say, in epidemiology? Bias is an error. It's an error that you can introduce in your study design or in your analysis when you attribute erroneously some characteristics that is not actually present. So, for example, a bias would be if you erroneously categorize an individual as exposed while this individual is actually not exposed. So this is typically an error. Error, they could also come, for example, from the instrument that you use to measure something. If you are trying to measure temperature and your thermometer is somehow inaccurate, then this will introduce a bias because you will make a measurement which is not corresponding to the true measurement. And usually the type of bias that are considered in observational studies and consider that the one that David has presented, they are the observational studies in epidemiology. The type of bias which are taken into consideration are basically, let's say, we can generalize and say you can have a selection bias, you can have an information bias, and you can have a confounding. Confounding is a slightly different concept from bias, and then we will see maybe more clearly after. But a selection bias is, for example, is when you select, let's say, individual or groups, and these are not basically representative of the group or individuals that you want to include in your study. Here, for example, is if you have a survey in which the participation to the survey is voluntary, then the people that will respond, they may not be representative of the population they come from. In the literature of the statistical method, there is a very good example of what could be a selection bias. In the election of the United States president many years ago, after World War II or around that period, they made some preliminary statistical inquiry survey in order to predict who was going to win the election. And the results of these, they clearly indicated that the president belonging to the conservative party was going to win the election. And actually, the things didn't go in that way. And there was a selection bias due to the fact that they made the interviews by phone. And at that time, the phone was, I mean, the families that had the phone available were those more rich family, more likely to vote for the Conservative Party. So there was a selection bias from the beginning because the population that had been selected to make the statistical survey was not a representative of the population, of the entire population. So this has introduced a bias in the survey, and the results actually were the opposite of what it was foreseen. Time for a question. If you can think of an example of selection bias with vaccine effectiveness studies, but I would also say even not in relation to vaccine effectiveness study, if you have any idea of a sort of selection bias that you may have experienced or seen. I see that somebody is typing.
So I think we just also had a comment while we, well, I'll keep you entertained, Giancarlo, while we wait for some questions or some feedback.
How much bias can we accept in a study? Well, there is always the possibility, obviously, to make errors. The statistical, let's say, There are two types of errors, we can say. Systematic errors is something that you can control and it should be somehow eliminated as much as possible. There is the statistical error, which is due to the fact that you are usually testing a sample of the population. So this will introduce a random error, and this error is somehow is not possible to eliminate at all. But it's possible to control. For example, if you use a larger sample size, you will be able to minimize the random error because you will have a more precise estimate of the parameter that you are trying to measure in your population. So the second type of error, random error, will always be present unless you don't test the entire population, which is obviously usually not possible, but you can control it. The systematic error is something that you have to look very careful about because that can be eliminated. It's only a matter of defining the way you are measuring things in such a way that you are able to avoid this type of systematic error. I hope I have answered to your question. So there is, let's say, the thing is to distinguish between the two type of errors that can be actually done whenever you are implementing a survey or a study or whatever it is.
And I think we were looking for a good example of selection bias in vaccine effectiveness studies. I don't see any examples yet.
Maybe I have an answer in the next slide that maybe will help in trying to look like, at least to see what a selection bias could look like. I see that Otira Lang is typing. I wait until finish and then I will move forward. Or maybe I can move maybe forward and then we can see if this was an additional question or not. Well, for example, and I think this is also has been mentioned before by David, an outbreak bias. An outbreak bias, is this a typical outbreak? What do we mean about this? I think this has been discussed in vaccine failure. You may have in the outbreak the two variables that you are trying to associate, the outcome variable, the presence of disease, and the vaccination done, that is the indicator of something that should have a protection factor. A typical outbreak, it's an important question because, for example, you may have the disease in a farm or in a village, and the vaccination has been carried out only 3 days ago. You would not expect to see the effect of the vaccination in such an outbreak. So obviously, in this case, you might create a false association because you might conclude that the vaccine didn't have any effect, but actually the lack of effect of the vaccine is not due to the vaccine on its own, but is due to the fact that the animals were vaccinated only three days ago. So this would not be, let's say, a typical outbreak. And this will also lead you to the point that in any case, you have to define somehow what a typical outbreak should be, which is similar to whenever you are conducting studying at individual animal level and you ask for a case definition, for example. So you define your case according to certain characteristics which must be present. This is valid also for the typical outbreak. And this will avoid as much as possible the introduction of a bias. And I was saying this can be entirely controlled because Here, the definition is up to the person that is designing the study. I move forward because maybe some of the comments that I see, maybe they are going to be answered with the next slide. Another type of bias is the information bias. So in this case, the data on exposure and outcomes that they may lead to a misclassification. And this information can come from the observer, and this means that the bias is introduced by the person that is collecting the data. This is sometimes the reason why in fully randomized clinical trial, for example, the observer, we say that these are blind study because the observer doesn't know. For example, when he's collecting the data, he doesn't know, or analyzing the data, he doesn't know if these data are coming from the individual that has the outcome of interest or doesn't have the outcome of interest. He doesn't know anything. In order to make your observation as more objective as possible. A responder bias is something that can be introduced by the person that is responding to the study. I have a practical example on this in my experience of working in some developing countries. We were investigating not for foot-and-mouth disease, but for avian influenza at that time. And the people in the village, they were so kind with us. We were seen as a guest, so they wanted to be nice with the guest. So they responded in a way that they thought that we would have liked to hear. So, for example, we were asking if they had chickens, and they said, "Yes, we have chicken," because they understood, or they thought that maybe this is what we would have liked to hear. And then when we said, "Okay, can we have a look at your chicken?" Then they say, "No, but we don't have any chicken." So that's, for example, a responder bias. In this case, it's let's say extreme. In some cases, the responder bias is because of the time between the event that you are interviewing. Maybe it happened months ago, and there is what is called usually a recall bias. The responder may not recall whether, and also in this case, he might be responding in a way that he thinks that is more appropriate. An instrument bias, I think I have mentioned to you before, it's something that is introduced when you are measuring something with an instrument that is imperfect. And in a case of, let's say, physical measurement can be a real instrument, but in the case sometimes of the survey, is the questionnaire design, which can introduce the bias. So always this type of bias can be overcome only if the questions that you are posing are very precise and they do not leave room for interpretation. Okay, so again, if you can think about information bias with vaccine effectiveness study. I see a comment, non-compliance of farmer. Well, non-compliance is something that if they tell you that they have not complied, you have a real information. The non-compliance is more related to the fact that in the implementation of your program, you might not reach the desired outcome that you want because some of the farmers, they are not complying with the vaccination program. So this is, it seems to me that this is more related to the implementation phase rather than the evaluation phase. This could be something that maybe you want to consider in terms of how to improve the participation of farmers in your vaccination program. But at this stage, it's not something related to the evaluation of the vaccine that you are using. Maybe it's a slightly different issue. Okay, so if there are no, let's say, no thinkings about what information bias can look like, I have, I think, an example in the next slide that I can show to you. And for example, as we said, the observer bias is the person asking questions may interpret partners' responses based on their own opinion. Sometimes you want to be able to demonstrate that your vaccine is performing so well that you might have the tendency let's say, to provide an answer that goes into one direction. Responder bias is already what we have said. They may have their own beliefs, so that the type of answer that they can provide is not actually answering to the question that you have posed. This is why it's so important that the questions are very clear, and the interviewer has to make sure that the farmers or whomever fully understand what is being asked. The recall bias I already mentioned to you. This is when things might have happened in the past, and people just do not recall what happened. And then obviously the case definition, as we said before, we mentioned before about the definition of what a typical outbreak is, but also the case definition, so at individual level, which obviously will affect the sensitivity and specificity of your, and this is related to your capacity of identifying as much correctly as possible the cases among the population. And this is also can be, let's say, somehow controlled, because the case definition is part of the things that they must be clarified in the design phase of your epidemiological study. Responder bias farmers are not disclosed. I'm reading one of the, yes, this is, for example, this could be one of the reasons they may not tell you the truth. They might have a reason to do that, but obviously this introduces bias because they are not providing you with the correct information. So in this case, the farmer has understood very well the question, but is not providing you with the answer. So this is a different problem, that not understanding the question. And then this, as I said before, the confounding it's a slightly different concept than a bias, because here is more to do with an association between the factor that you consider to be responsible for an outcome, and this factor is also associated with another factor, and there is no causal association between these factors and the outcome. Let's take this example, which was, I think, prepared by Nick Lyon. Murder rates, it's associated with weather conditions, which means that when there is a very hot weather, somehow people maybe get more crazy, and you can observe that with hot weather, you can have an increasing in the murder rates because people are more nervous. I don't know, whatever can affect an increasing rate in murders. Now, it's also true that during hot weather, there is a higher consumption of ice cream. So if you measure the increased consumption of ice cream, this might be falsely associated with increasing of the murder rates, which in fact is not true. So this pose you another issue, that it must be also a biological plausibility in order that the association can be considered credible. But this is what happens sometimes when you are trying to study, for example, and we will see another example that maybe is more explanatory in the next slide. When you are trying to study association between one or more risk factors and an outcome of interest, you must consider the possibility that the effect that you are observing is masked by the effect of a confounding variable. I will try to explain this better in the next slide. Confounding, for example, leads you to a question that is fundamental, and this is fundamental especially for the type of observational studies that David has mentioned to you before. The question is, if you want to measure vaccine effectiveness, the problem is that the risk of exposure must be the same between those that have been vaccinated and those that were not vaccinated. Because if they have the same level of exposure, this will allow you to measure if the fact that the group of animals was vaccinated had a different, the exposure had a different impact on these animals if compared with the animals that were not vaccinated. And here, the issue of confounding, for example, is that you can have a healthy user bias, as proposed here. People that are vaccinating their animals, they are less likely to develop disease. But this might not be due only to the effect of vaccine. This is also because maybe these farmers that they vaccinate, they also have a behavior, they also have an attitude that will reduce their risk. They, for example, these farmers, they may adopt, in addition to vaccination, biosecurity measures, which obviously will contribute to protect their animals. So in this case, it's not only the effect of vaccine, but it's also the effect of something else. Actually, here we enter into another, but we don't go into that, but it's called the effect modification. You have a synergic effect between two variables which are going in the same direction. Or conversely, you can have what is called the fragility bias, meaning that sometimes the attitude of the farmers that vaccinate their animals is more, we can say, superficial. They say, oh, yes, no, I have vaccinated my animals, so I don't have to worry about anything. This is obviously not true. But this also can be a compounding factor because the lack of effectiveness may be attributed entirely to the vaccine, while there might be other variables which can influence the outcome. So, for example, in this case, in relation to the FMD occurrence, these two variables can go in the same direction. Vaccination will imply that you expect a reduction of FMD cases, but also the biosecurity measures. So if these two variables, if this vaccination and biosecurity are associated, meaning that those farmers that vaccinate, they also have a behavior so that they will adopt more biosecurity measures than those farmers that do not vaccinate, this may act as a confounding variable, meaning that can attribute the effect of a greater effect to vaccination, while the overall effect is due because the two factors are working in synergy. And the other point is that the confounding should usually be, let's say, thought about confounding variable in the phase of designing the study. Because if you do not collect the data about the confounders, you will not be able to evaluate if there is some variable acting as a confounder among in your study. So this is why it is extremely important in the design phase to think about what can confound the results of your study, say. The other point here is that the crude, I mean, unadjusted vaccine effectiveness estimates, they must be taken with extreme cautions because, in fact, when you are analyzing data, crude data, you might have confounders that you are not able to identify only analyzing crude ratio or whatever you are trying to analyze. So in terms of vaccine effectiveness studies for FMD, for example, the animals should only be considered as vaccinated only if they have been vaccinated at least 7 days before, which means that, as I said before, if you have an outbreak and the vaccination has been carried out, let's say 2 days ago, that will not be a typical outbreak because you will never be able to measure the effectiveness, the efficacy of your vaccine. Need to consider the possibility of that. I mean, you need to consider the time since vaccination and the fact that the animals may have received multiple doses during their life. So the age of the animals is something important that you want to consider. Vaccine effectiveness study can be cheap, but there is a but, and they need a careful planning, and the approach has to be very much systematic. Collecting data on risk factor as well as to gain an understanding of the disease, and then these studies usually they need to be done soon after an outbreak is finished, in order that you will avoid as much as possible the recall bias. If you go to visit an outbreak after 1 year, it's likely that the farmer will not have a We will not have a fresh memory of what has happened. So it's this is one of the conditions in order for the study to be as much reliable as possible. And this is one simple way through which you can tabulate your data. In this case, the data they are calculated as a crude vaccine effectiveness. So you have in one column the number of animals which have been vaccinated, yes or no. You have 1,687 animals vaccinated, and then you have 92 animals that have not been vaccinated. What you do is you measure the incidence or proportion of cases among vaccinated and the proportion of cases among the non-vaccinated. And the vaccine effectiveness, as David has mentioned before, is 1 minus the ratio between the incidence in vaccinated versus the incidence in unvaccinated, which in the case of this table is the ratio between 16.2%. This is the proportion, this is the risk of being a case among those vaccinated, and this is the risk of being a case among those non-vaccinated. By putting this in the equation, you have that the vaccine effectiveness is 35%. 35% is the reduction of incidence due to the vaccination. This is the observed reduction of incidence due to the vaccination. And as David mentioned before, this is not is not measuring the impact at general population level. Because you might have, for example, a program that is targeting a very specific sector. So the vaccination may have an impact in that population, in the population target for your vaccination program. But if you try to measure the impact at general population level, it may be negligible. And the reason is because the target population may be a negligible proportion over the entire population. An example that I have in this regard is a vaccination program implemented, for example, in Pakistan, targeting a very specific sector, but the animals belonging to the sector is a very small proportion of animals if compared with the overall population. So the vaccination program had a strong impact in the target population, but a negligible impact in the overall population. So these things are two different things that they should be considered. As I said before, the crude estimates, they may contain confounders that you are not able to detect through the crude analysis. So usually the methods for adjusting the data are or by stratifying the data. There is a specific method called Mantel-Ansel method to analyze stratified data, Or you can use statistical models like binomial or logistic regression. With this methodology, you will be able to observe if there are confounders. Obviously, the condition is that you have collected the data about the confounders. There is actually another method we can say, but this is not actually a method to evaluate a vaccine effectiveness, but it's a methodology that somehow it may be simple to use, especially in larger scale farms or in an epidemiological unit like village. And this is based on the fact that you might have in your animals present in your larger scale operations, you might have a very good records on disease, and you might also have good records about the vaccination. So in this case, one of the let's say methodology that you can use, but again, this is not to estimate the vaccine effectiveness, but it's only to observe if incidence of disease is particularly high in those sectors, in those age groups, let's say, which have maybe received less doses of vaccine. So this is, for example, a situation in which this is a profile that you can observe. When let's say the vaccine may not be very effective. And the reason why we say this is because we have on the x-axis the number of doses. So the animals are grouped by the number of doses of vaccine that they have received. And in the y-axis you have the FMD incidence. So what we observe in this graph is that the incidence increases rapidly in those animals which have received less doses of vaccine, and then remains more or less stable in animals that have received multiple doses of vaccine. There is an incidence plateau among the older animals. This might be a situation typical of endemic states, for example, and this is an indication also that maybe the vaccination in this case is not properly working, because what we would expect is actually to see a reduction in the incidence. The incidence, remember, is the occurrence of new cases in your population. In this case, the population is represented by the animals in a large, let's say, imagine a large dairy farm. And so, for example, this profile is showing you that the incidence rate progressively decrease with increasing let's say age group, increasing age, which is a proxy of the number of doses that the animals might have received. So this is an indication that would imply that some vaccine effectiveness is actually in place, because you expect to see less disease in those animals which have been repeatedly vaccinated. Again, this method is not a method to evaluate vaccine effectiveness, because you are not comparing in a case like a larger scale farm. Let's say all the animals have been vaccinated, so you might lack the controls of the unvaccinated animals. But it's a method to assess if you can attribute some effectiveness to the vaccine that you are using by observing the incidence rate in different age groups. And in this different age group, the age is a proxy of the number of doses that the animals might have received. So this is concluding my presentation, and I would welcome if you have any questions.